Welcome to the Vantage HR Influencers Podcast. This podcast is sponsored by Vantage Circle, the simple and AI-powered rewards and recognition platform for employee engagement.
Employee benefits, they're changing dramatically as the workplace evolves. If you ask any employer today how important employee benefits are to achieving the company's objectives and goals, they'll surely tell you that they are the most crucial. In fact, employers are growing increasingly attentive to the employees' requirements and are attempting to match the benefit plans to those demands. In this episode of the Vantage HR Influencers Podcast, let's know more about employee benefits. I'm Sushmita, and today our guest speaker is Enrique Rubio, an HR, tech, and future of work expert and keynote speaker and founder of Hacking HR, a global learning community at the intersection of the future of work, technology, business, and organizations with thousands of members from all over the world. Welcome to the show, Enrique.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Once again, thank you so much for joining me. So before we start with the topic today, employee benefits, let's know a small, brief about your journey in the corporate world.
Yeah, well, just briefly, I started my career as an engineer. I am an electronic engineer. And then a little over 10 years ago, I got a little bored of just working with technology, even though I love technology. And I wanted to do something different. And I found the world of HR, human resources, and I became very passionate about it, and I decided to switch from engineering to HR. Mm. So I started working in consulting, then I did corporate work, and now I'm just being, full time with my work in Hacking HR. But that's how my career started, from engineering to HR, now, to entrepreneur, and, all the pieces come together very nicely in all that I do.
Right. So what's up about Hacking HR? What do you do basically?
Well, Hacking HR is a global learning community of HR leaders, HR practitioners from all over the world that we bring together through events, chapters, learning programs, our social platform called the Hacking HR Lab. And we bring all this community together for three things. Number one, to learn and bring HR sort of up to speed to the new world of work and to become a leader, in business. Number two, for all of this community to, create community and come together. And number three, for them to be able to collaborate, to find opportunities to work in projects, in programs, solving challenges and tackling opportunities together. And that's ultimately what we do. And we do all of that at the intersection of all the topics that are around future of work, technology, organizations, people, transformation, innovation, and evidently how all of that impacts the world of HR. So Hacking HR is a global learning community. We bring people together for learning, community, and collaboration.
I'm sure you must be teaching, training HR about employee benefits as well. And that's the topic that we have taken up today for the discussion.
Yeah, we do include some conversations around benefits, especially when they pertain the thinking of benefits aligned with this new world of work, rather than just as a transaction that HR has to run, more from the design perspective, more from the understanding of how to sort of rethink or reframe compensation and benefits to have companies and organizations that are competitive to attract and retain, the greatest talent that they can attract and retain.
Yeah, I'm sure that employee benefits is a wide, it's a wide thing, it's a broad thing to discuss. But let's start with the questions. So first of all, the often asked question, Enrique, what are employee benefits, or how do you define employee benefits and why are they important?
Yeah, well, let me begin by saying what's not only employee benefits. And basically, when you look at the traditional model of benefits, you generally think about elements such as, of course, the salary that somebody's earning for doing their job. Yeah. You think about the time they get, for sick leave or for, their paid time off. and maybe you think about some added still traditional benefits like, you know, paying perhaps for, you know, children education or for the very workers education and things of the kind. Mm. So traditionally, those are sort of the elements that fall in the category of employee benefits. But the way I think about it is it's broader than that. And it is everything that you use to, number one, compensate, you know, not only financially, but in the many other ways that you can compensate somebody for the work that they are doing. And number two, the sort of what you provide and what you give back to your employees to provide them with a great human experience at work and make sure that they have all they need from you as an employer for them to be able as employees to deliver the promise of high performance, high productivity, high value at work. So it's a much more comprehensive idea here that goes well beyond just salary and you know, some of the other benefits that I just mentioned.
Right. So of course, like employee benefits, it also depends on the, you know, what the different generations want. So it's definitely a very dynamic thing, right? So what kind of employee benefits are the most popular among the various generations in the US?
Well, if the first thing that I got to say about this question and about all the questions that pertain to benefits is that you need to start from a baseline, right? If your people are underpaid and overworked, it's very hard to think about other benefits that are not the salary that you need to be paying to those people. So the questions that I'm going to respond now and, you know, into the podcast, into our conversation, what I'm thinking is that we are beginning from a baseline of you as a company, as an employer, paying your people a decent salary that makes sure that rewards them for the work they do and compensates them for the work they do in a decent way. Again, I gotta say this because, you know, I wanna talk about elements such as, you know, employee experience, human experience and all that. But if somebody's underpaid at work, it's really hard to have any of these conversations, right? You need to start from the basic of the pyramid, if we can call it that way, you know, when we think about Abraham Maslow. So beginning from that baseline of paying people a decent salary that truly dignifies their contribution to work, you know, then you move on to, for example, I think the one benefit that now has become very powerful because of COVID, and this applies across generations, is flexibility in the way people work. And when I say flexibility, I say that concept very broadly, because for somebody who is perhaps very, you know, like in their mid, late, you know, senior leadership careers, maybe for them, flexibility means, you know, making sure that they can spend, say, time with family while doing the work they do. And in a very tactical way, that may, for example, mean that they want to work in a schedule that accommodates for them to give priority to their family and at the same time deliver whatever, you know, deliverables they need to be working on in their jobs.
Yeah, so basically the work-life balance.
Yeah, but I don't like it to call it work-life balance because that entails, you know, somehow that you need to keep a level of, again, you know, balance between work and life. And sometimes work takes a little bit of priority and sometimes life takes a little bit of priority. So there's, you know, to have this balance really depends on a number of factors. And I like to talk about flexibility because it's, once again, it's from you as a company putting the decision on how to work on the hands of the employee. You have to make sure as an employer that you are communicating what the expectations are, what the expected outcomes are. So you're communicating the why they are doing what they are doing. But the what and the how, you know, the nitty gritty, that benefit is what I call flexibility. And that, you know, if you can put that in the hands of an employee, then you are creating a great opportunity for empowerment and a great opportunity for people to say, you know what, if I am getting this benefit right now, the benefit of deciding you know, with flexibility, deciding what makes sense for me. Maybe I don't work from 8 to 5. Maybe I work like myself, you know, I wake up at, you know, 3-4 in the morning, mm-hmm. and I start working at that time. But at 2 or 3 PM, I'm already like, you know, burned and I don't want to work anymore. But there are some other people that are like, you know, their day begins at 1 PM and ends at midnight because that's the way they like to work. So if you provide that benefit of flexibility, you are empowering your employee to decide how to work in the way that is best for them. And that one benefit, I think, as of now, trumps mostly every other benefit. Again, taking as a baseline the fact that you're paying your people well, but that employee benefit of flexibility applies across the board, across generations, in different ways, but it's the underlying principle of flexibility.
Right, right. So basically what you mentioned, Enrique, is that first of all, HR should take care of the salary, right? So if the salary is not up to the mark of the expectations of the employees, all other benefits doesn't make much importance to them, right?
I think it's important for them to shape some things and to architect, because for example, at the end of the day, I mean, you can be flexible, but there will always be boundaries to flexibility, right? I mean, if somebody comes to you and says, hey, you're going to hire me to do this job, but I only want to work 1 month out of the entire year and I still want you to pay me. I mean, that's ridiculous to just say it. Exactly. And that's never going to happen. Yeah. So there are some boundaries, but the highlight here is that traditionally the way we have thought about benefits and mostly everything else in HR is first with boundaries and then feeding people within those boundaries. And what I'm proposing here, and not just me, by the way, a lot of people talking about this, but what we are proposing here is how do you keep those boundaries clear, but you make sure that you give people enough opportunity to operate within those boundaries. I think this becomes a problem when HR, and when I say HR, by the way, I don't mean HR by itself, I mean HR representing the company that they work for. Because it's probably not HR just out of their own sheer will. It's because they are representing a company. When they force, for example, people to work from 9 to 5, 5 days a week, you know, when to take them off, what to, you know, how to do their work. So if instead of thinking that way, HR says, you know what, these are, you know, we are educating our leaders and our organization to focus on deliverables, on results, on outcomes, rather than focusing on inputs or outputs. And when you change your mindset in that way, what you are doing is telling people, I don't mind if you work 8 hours in one day or 7 hours or 9 hours, as long as you are delivering your one product that you needed to deliver this week. And let me go back to your question about generations. There are some people that, they like the way they produce their work is by sitting in a computer and cranking up that keyboard, all the time. There are some other people that learn differently. Like, for example, me, I am in the computer, but I like to go for a run 1 or 2 times a day. And when I'm running outside, I am thinking, I am creating stuff in my mind, and then I come back to the computer and actually start executing on them. I don't want anybody to tell me you have to be sitting in the computer from 8 to 5 because that's the way we measure productivity here, because that for me would not make sense. And the same applies to a lot of people that have different ways of working. So okay. Once again, this ultimate goal of thinking of benefits in a very flexible approach.
Yeah. So as you rightly mentioned, so it is different for different people, right? Wants to work in this way or the other one wants to work in the other way. So how do you know that this is the best benefit program that seems to be right for your company with multi-generational employees?
Because there's science that already proves that. For such a long time, we relied on, there were two things happening, like two opposing currents. The current of how work was working, which was not really working at all, because forcing people to behave in a way that is not natural to them was actually counterproductive to the company. And the other opposing current to that was people who knew that if you gave your employees freedom and flexibility, they would work better and deliver better value. So those opposing currents were going sort of alongside for a long time. But what we do have now is the science that proves that when people can make decisions on how they want to work, on the how, on the what, and they have that flexibility, they actually deliver more value, their performance is higher, their productivity is higher and whatnot. So the case to make this sort of the way a business operates right now, this flexible approach, relies on the fact that we do have the science to show that, and that, again, flexibility, what is providing, you know, there are boundaries, as I said before, but when you are telling people we want to be a more flexible workplace, what you are telling them is we still have to be productive, we still have to deliver high performance, we still have to produce our outcomes and our deliverables, but we don't want to tell you every nitty gritty on how to do this. We want you to make decisions on how to do that. We want you to be empowered to be able to make those determinations. That creates a whole new level of commitment to the work and, you know, of, I think, of performance and productivity. And again, the science is there to show that that is actually the case.
So this flexible approach that you were talking about, Enrique, so this seems to be the best employee benefit that a company can provide to its remote workers, right? But what about the people who have to go to office from 9 and work from 9 to 5? They don't get that option for flexibility, isn't it?
That is a fantastic question. And this is what happens. There are people who will never be able to work remotely at any time because they work, you know, if you are a waitress or a waiter, you have to be in the restaurant where you're working, right? Or in the coffee shop, whatever it is. If you are the receptionist of a hospital, you have to be there. So, you know, to backtrack from there a little bit, one thing that the organization has to decide is what are the types of jobs that can have, you know, certain kinds of flexibility. And you have to acknowledge that there are some jobs that will have more, quote unquote, more flexibility, or flexibility that looks different than other kind of flexibility, compared to other workers in that one organization. So number one, you gotta think through this very, very carefully as, you know, HR leader and as a business leader in your organization. Then the second thing you gotta do, of course, is you have to communicate these decisions with transparency, honesty, and, you know, creating some space for people to also be creative about this. And what I mean by that is that if you have the bartender, the barista working in the coffee shop, I mean, I don't think any of them would ever expect any flexibility where they can actually do work from home because they know that that's not the job that they are doing. Mm-hmm. But when they see that their coworkers can work from home, that may create a little tension that you have to manage by communicating clearly about why some people can have that level of flexibility and why those that need to be in the actual office, don't have that one level of flexibility. So number one, decide from the beginning, as I mentioned before, you know, what jobs can have more flexibility than others. Number two, it is communicating with transparency, clarity, honesty, why you're making some determinations. And number three is that even though some jobs require some people to go to be in the office all the time, maybe you may think about a different kind of flexibility for them. Maybe you add a little bit of extra time off for them. Maybe you add, you know, a little bit of extra off hours during the week for them that you may not offer to people that have the other kind of flexibility. Mm-hmm. So again, this goes back to the principle of if you are putting forward the concept of flexibility, what that means is that it's not going to be the same necessarily for everybody. And that is okay. I don't think anybody in the workplace is expecting to operate in the same way that other people are operating. And therefore, one person's flexibility may be somebody else's constraints and vice versa. So you got to be very clear about this within the boundaries of what you can actually do.
Yeah, so all these are, you know, appropriate for small and medium-sized firms as well, right? Yeah.
Well, not necessarily. I mean, there are very large organizations doing this now. Mm-hmm. I mean, recently, I think it was SAP, IBM, Deloitte, Microsoft, Google, Facebook, TikTok, and PwC. All of these companies have told their employees, you know, you have flexibility. You know, we don't want, you know, you don't have to come back to the office if you don't want to come back to the office. Yeah. And we're talking about companies that have 50, 60, 100, 200,000 employees. Yeah. So I actually think it's sometimes quite the opposite. You know, sometimes it's a little more difficult for smaller companies that, you know, the way they operate requires a different base of communication, right, among their employees, and there may be you know, sort of a stronger temptation for them to be together in a physical space rather than for these large organizations where everybody's, you know, kind of like focusing like one smaller piece of the entire product of that one company.
So I mentioned that in small and medium-sized firms, that you also said that communication becomes a major challenge, you know, when we're working from home. So that might not be the problem in a giant corporation.
Well, if you do it right, it should not be a problem anywhere, you know, neither in the small nor in the bigger organizations. But what happens is that generally, you know, smaller organizations, and I say this because I have worked in both big and small organizations. When you work in a small organization, because probably say that you work in a, you know, 20 people, a small startup or organization, most likely every one of those 20 people will be doing a number of tasks and projects and activities that in a larger organization would be spread out among maybe more people, right? So that means that the pace, the frequency, the kind of communication that you need in those small teams is different, faster, you know, it has a different approach than those in larger organizations. So what I mean is that this could be one reason why those small companies may want their people to come back together in person to make sure that there are no frictions at all in their communication process. In larger organizations, that can happen as well, but because there are so many more people, and so very often there are so many more tools to make these communication processes seamless, I don't want to say that it's easier, but it's definitely different. So maybe they have less of a temptation to force people back into the office than a small organization.
Okay, so Enrique, what is your take on the employee benefits softwares and platforms that we see today?
Well, again, it depends on how people think about employee benefits. If you're thinking about benefits just as in the salary and PTO, or, you know, sick days, you know, paid sick leave, then you need a very transactional, you know, kind of technology tools. But if you're thinking about benefits in terms of flexibility, which is the one sort of common topic that we have discussed throughout this podcast, if you think about flexibility in that way, I'm sorry, about benefits in that way, then you may need, for example, tools that allow you for a seamless communication among your team. And there are tools that do that. I don't generally mention any tools, just to be respectful of all the people that, you know, come to our community. But you have communication tools. You have tools that allow you to take a poll surveys or measure employee productivity, engagement, and experience, performance on a very regular basis, and that allows you to make quick decisions. Mm-hmm. So technology is there basically to do anything you want, and especially to be able to personalize the human experience of your people at work, which means that you can further this concept of flexibility. Because as we spoke before, flexibility looks different for every person. And you said it, you know, not only across generations, but within generations, people are very different. So flexibility has very different flavors to it. And technology can allow you to make sure that you truly understand how each of your individual workers actually feel about this concept of flexibility, and how they want to actually put it forward, implement this concept of flexibility. So anyway, there's technology for everything. It is you as an HR leader, as a business leader, in your design of benefits and flexibility, the person who would have to decide, you know, what you want flexibility to look like in big terms for your company, and then bring the technology on board to help you do that.
Right. So if we look into the specific benefits and perks of tech companies from around the world, which are the companies with the best employee packages or employee benefits that you see?
Once again, I don't talk about specifics of, company names, just to be mindful of, we have a very diverse community, in Hacking HR, and I remain very mindful about that without having necessarily to pinpoint to any specific company.
Yeah, sure.
But, when you look across the board, especially, you look at the space of technology companies, and I don't just want to say, Silicon Valley kind of companies, but when you look at the space of technology, there are companies in that space doing, a very innovative stuff, not only to leverage on the data, truly understand what flexibility could mean for them, but at the same time, they are acting on that data and saying, we are finding that people are being productive and delivering high performance when they are working remotely. So for some of those companies, the question becomes, why would we want to bring them back to the office if they are delivering high performance when they are working remotely, whether from home or a co-working space or whatever it is? So they leverage on the data and then they act on that data. So, without mentioning any name, I think the companies that are being very successful in this way are companies that are truly unpacking the concept of flexibility and making sure that they are acting on it, not only as a human imperative, but also because they have the science that is telling them that making those kind of flexible decisions or flexible approach to work is actually delivering high value for them.
Indeed. Okay. So, Enrique, any suggestions that you would want to give to our HR listeners today?
Just the last one is, I think the common theme in our conversation today was flexibility, right? And we boiled all of it down to flexibility benefits and human experience and whatnot. And the one recommendation for HR people would be flexible. Be flexible. You don't have to control everything. You don't have to know everything. People want freedom to work these days. I mean, this is funny because, Susmita, I have never in my life come across anybody who tells me I hate work. What they tell me is I hate work or this job that I have, or I hate this approach to work. But I have never heard of anybody telling me that they hate the actual growing personally and professionally through delivering the craft that they enjoy doing. And what this means is that if people already enjoy sort of delivering that kind of value and doing things in a way that makes sense for them, make sure that you leverage on that and you maximize the opportunities that can come from that. And the way to do it is making sure that you give enough freedom to your people to decide how to best deliver that craft instead of telling them how to do it. Because then you are basically treating them like if they were children of, 3 years old children, rather than adults that, have gone through experience in life and know, how to what to do and what not to do. They may need coaching, of course, and mentoring and support, but give them the freedom. So be flexible. That's it. Build a workplace around flexibility, but you individually as an HR leader or as a business leader, be flexible.
Brilliant. Finally, Enrique, how can our listeners reach out to you?
Mainly LinkedIn. That's my main means of communication. Enrique Rubio. LinkedIn. They can go also to our Hacking HR LinkedIn page or our Hacking HR website, hackinghr.io. And, I'd love to continue to connect with people and learn from everybody and hopefully share some of my insights as well. So thank you.
Thanks for all your insights, Enrique. Thanks a lot for joining me in the Vantage HR Influencers podcast.
Thank you so much, Susmita, for inviting me.
Thanks for listening to the Vantage HR Influencers podcast. Please do subscribe to Vantage HR Influencers podcast on Apple Podcast, Spotify, and our YouTube channel for new episodes.